My Bat Mitzvah determines the rest of my life. If I have a kick-ass party, doors would open. And I just think Dua Lipa would make the party perfect.
You can have a ball pit.
That's for kids. I've had my period for 7 months now.
That's a long period, sweetheart.
La 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 la. I'm not popular.
What is happening? You look insane.
Slay queen. I'm not a loser. I look like the lady that pulls kids out of class when their parents get into car accidents.
How often does that happen?
I might be a little obsessed.
One day, Dandy Goldfarb will be mine, and you will have a cool boyfriend too, and then we'll have a joining loss in Tribeca in Taylor Swift's building. Yeah. Oh my God. Oh my God.
Please,
no, let me explain to you. We are no longer friends.
Yo, shit just got real.
I love this movie. It is so good. I'm a huge coming of age fan, but this one was just, I mean, I really think it's one of the best films of the year. It's really incredible.
My God, thank you.
One of the things I really love is just right off the bat, how Stacey mentions, you know, it's hard to be a teenage girl, a girl in middle school, which I really relate to. And I was wondering, what do you remember as one of the most challenging experiences when you were in middle school?
Oh man, that's a good question. I think a lot of it, I think, is really similar, but felt so like, I thought it was just me as a 13-year-old kid. I think the biggest thing for me is this idea of presenting who you are, like having to sort of present and like put out, you know, we all kind of have these internal versions of ourselves, but then the idea of like, okay, we need to look and sound and acclimate in a certain way to be accepted. I think I remember in middle school, now I can sort of explain it, but I think it's like, I felt like I had to be a certain way to be loved and accepted by my peers. And I felt like I couldn't make mistakes. I had to be perfect and exactly what everyone wanted and liked. And then you learn that's not necessarily the case.
Yeah. Good lesson you learned in this film too. And also in this movie, you see how intense like crushes are whenever you're like in middle school and high school. Like, I feel like you are the crushes you have during that time never feel that way after high school or something. Why do you think that is? Why are our crushes so intense when we're that young?
I think it's because the first time you experience anything, it's so heightened because it's the first time and you have less years and less, you know, experiences to compare to. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of as simple as that. I think for Stacey, we talked about that a lot in many facets of this film, because I think the first time you do anything, like I said, it's just like the highest high. So it feels that, you know, like if you fall, it'll be the lowest low.
That's a good point. I never thought about it that way. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Well, also we see, you know, in this movie, just like you said, the importance of friendship. And I have to say, like, for some reason, seeing Stacey and Lydia, like, break up, like their friendship breakup, it hit harder in this movie than anything I've ever seen. Like, it was like breaking my heart watching them not be friends. And I was wondering, what do you think is the key to showing an authentic friendship on screen?
I think, well, it's funny how much weight we put on romantic relationships. Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. The love story here is this platonic friendship between these two girls. I think the key is messiness and vulnerability and like the sloppiness that comes with like raw, you know, you're a raw nerve at 13. And I think in the most beautiful way, you're not as contained and controlled. And I think like, yeah, what I loved about the script and then what mm-hmm. was important is like, it's messy. They don't do everything perfectly. And like, they're human beings. But like, you know, your friends continue to help you figure out who you are. And yeah, I don't know if that makes sense, but that's the biggest thing.
No. I do. I think it does. So I'm curious, what's the quality that you most value in your best friend?
I think there's three. I think it's a safe space to show up as I am, not always perfectly. Yeah. I think, yeah, honesty and like acceptance and love. It's like really simple. just like, yeah, this idea of like, I think my friends, I have the best friends and they, yeah, they love me no matter what. I can fuck up. They still love me.
Yeah. Well, and not all friends are like that. So that's true. Yeah. That's a good point. Well, something else I loved about this movie was the soundtrack. I loved all the music, but I have to ask, I feel like, I don't know if it was like an inside joke or what, like what was the tease with Don't Stop Believing by Journey? Because I feel like I was wanting to hear it, but we were just getting like a joke about like about to play it. And I know Adam Sandler has used that in other films. So I wasn't sure if there was something there with that song.
That was a bit that was that we developed for Schmooly. I mean, it's the song that I feel like it's the joke. It's like the song that we all hear at every bat mitzvah that we all request. And I think it was sort of like paying homage to the song without ever seeing that through. And I just love that, like, yeah, I think it's like as simple as like, I love that Aaron, like this generation, every generation still knows and references that song.
Yeah.
But yeah, at the end you get the Commodores Easy, you get that song in there, that classic, but we never play that because it would ruin the joke.
Yeah, no, that's great. And another reason I really love coming of age movies in general is just I like remembering my teen years and kind of feeling that nostalgia. I was wondering what is it about coming of age movies that you most enjoy?
I mean, I think that's such a good question. I feel like I love that, like, adolescence is like this fun roller coaster, right? Like, it's fast, it's exciting, there's highs and lows. Most of the time you're having a blast, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden you think you're gonna die, and that's what being 13 feels like to me.
Yeah.
But I think, like, I've also always been interested in stories about adolescence because I think as kids, like I said, they're like raw nerves. We don't have I call it like the adult filter. We don't have that on yet.
Yeah.
And so I think like as adults, we form these coping mechanisms that keep our emotions like tempered and so controlled. Kids are less filtered and feel their feelings on these larger scale because we're doing this for the first time. And like, I think that's why what I kind of love. I love that it's messy. I love that it's like a reminder that we all go through this thing.
Yeah.
It's not really just contained to middle school or high school or whatever. We come to age like over and over and over in our lives. Mm-hmm. And so we're like so far from 13. We still totally understand what that feels like. Yeah, I don't know. That was a tangent, but
no. I mean, it's so true. I feel like I always, I don't know. Those are my favorite kind of like the setting of that, like middle school and high school, and then just like the coming of age. And I mean, I'm 35 and I feel like I don't know if I'll ever outgrow that. I think that's just like what I gravitate towards a lot. So it's just interesting to me, like why I still like that. Like, I don't feel like I outgrow the coming of age movies, but it's just,
I think there's two things too. I think part of it is I love the nostalgia and I love being able to reflect back on middle school is a very challenging time for me.
Yeah.
I think for most of us, like it's weird to say, but I was so depressed in middle school and I was so lost. And I think like, it's kind of nice to revisit that time in life because there's like some nostalgia and good feeling. And it's also a good reminder of like, everything is temporary and you will be okay. Yes. And we're all still figuring it out. And there's like something so like, yeah, I'll never outgrow this genre. I love it.
Yeah.
No,
and it's great. I love the movie Crush too. So I hope you keep doing these. I also love seeing the scene where, you know, Stacey and her dad went to like John Hughes movies, just because John Hughes, surprise, I mean, he's one of my favorite directors of all time. But I know in the production notes you referenced a quote of his, how people forget when you're 16 and you think seriously about the big questions then.
Yeah.
So I was wondering if you remember what big questions you thought of when you were 16 or around that age that you might still be thinking about now.
Oh, great question. I think today kids even have to do that younger. I think back then 16, now I'm like, these kids are there at like 12, 13.
Yes.
I think for me, it was the first time I felt like this more existential notion of like who I am and who am I supposed to be. I think for me, some of the big questions were, I mean, they feel small now, but like, what am I supposed to say? I think it was just like, how do I hide so that I can just get through this moment? Like, what am I supposed to say? What am I supposed to do? You know what? Here's a better reason. I think a part of me was like, how do I be me and also be accepted? That was kind of the question.
That's a good question.
The way to distill. Yeah. Cause that, yeah. And those things seem to like not necessarily feel like they fit together. So how do I be me, but how do I be accepted at the same time?
Yeah. Yeah. And it really is. It's just so amazing. It's great to see that in this movie when, you know, Stacey does come to realize it, just like learning what is important and how, I mean, it's just, if we could learn that at a young age, because I didn't learn it at a young age, like, I wish I knew that it didn't matter. Like, you just focus on the people that accept you for who you are and you're going to be fine. Cause in hindsight, especially when you get older. Yeah. But I also have to ask, because Breakfast Club is my number one movie, my number one favorite movie of all time. I have to go, what is your favorite John Hughes movie?
That's my second. Ferris Bueller.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Ferris Bueller is like one of my top. Breakfast Club is such a close second, right behind Ferris Bueller.
So good. So good. Just like so excited to see that. And then just going on movies, I thought it was funny how Ronnie would keep watching like horror films yes. on her phone. I was just curious if you had to watch just to kill some time, what's your horror movie you're going to watch on your phone?
Honestly, it's a cliche answer, but like a Stephen King movie. The Shining is my go-to.
Mm-hmm.
Go-to.
Great one. Well, yeah. They are wrapping me up, but this has been so much fun. I really enjoyed speaking with you.
Likewise. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you. You too.
Bye.
What's the matter? Something bugging you?
She betrayed me. She kissed my crush and then he touched her on her boob and pee. A, B, C, D, E,
F, U. Oi, underboob. Hey, I got plenty of that.
You're not taking this seriously.
You used to be such a respectful kid.
I volunteered at the retirement home.
So you could do a mitzvah, or so you could flirt with a boy.
Facts. Real talk.
I don't know what's happening between you two.
Lydia has long black hairs on her nipples.
You wouldn't happen to know why people keep asking me if they can floss their teeth with my nipple hair. Do you, Stacey?
No.
I know what she needs because I know how she's feeling. She needs to process this herself.
I know she hurt you, but I'm sure she misses her best friend.
I'm gonna take that as a maybe. I'm so
I've tried to apologize.
When is it enough?
Now it's enough.
It's too late.
You don't shape up. Your bat mitzvah is gonna be canceled, sis.
Dad, just talk to her. Don't yell.
Gabby.
You're a jerk and you won't let me have a mojito bar.
That's why we fought the Nazis.
Is this a bad time?
So you can have a mojito bar.
She's growing up so fast. It's crazy.
I'm drinking now.
I tried it the other day. I didn't like it. We're good.